Hey there, I'm Lee Ullman here with some big news from the National Young Farmers Coalition. We're partnering with Heritage Radio Network on a special season of The Farm Report. It's all about what's happening with the Farm Bill and how it impacts farmers and eaters.
I am growing diversified vegetables on land that's been in our family for 150 years.
And so with the pandemic, gentrification, property values going up, we had to sell the land and we lost it.
Join us as we uncover the untold stories behind this massive piece of legislation that shapes how we grow our food, what we eat, and so much more.
The problems we have had, those are things that come from earlier Farm Bill and USDA policy, right? Like Earl Butts, get big or get out.
You know, it's my responsibility to know not only what I'm eating, but then like how that all came to be and realize like, wow, like this piece of legislation, all this money, like it's technically something that I support as a taxpayer.
While Congress debates the next Farm Bill, this is not just an invitation to listen. It's a call to action. Be part of the conversation. Subscribe to the Farm Report on Heritage Radio Network, wherever you listen to podcasts.
Today's program was brought to you by Roth Cheese, a pioneer in the U.S. specialty cheese movement. For more information, visit rothcheese.com.
Meat and Three is Heritage Radio Network's weekly food news roundup. This week on Meat and Three, we're bringing you highlights from Feast Portland, like our chat with the one and only Andrew Zimmern.
I'm super excited to be here because for people who do what I do for a living, we do tons of, you know, desk side chats and podcasts and interviews and stuff like that. And you circle the handful of ones in a year where you get to talk with people that you're really excited about talking with. So this is awesome.
We picked up on some recurring themes while talking to our impressive roster of guests, including the current state of Portland's food scene, personal identity, and believe it or not, the influence of great chefs' grandmothers.
Meemaw never touched a drop of booze in her life and now has a distillery named after her. But I grew up in her garden and just really, she taught me all good things come from scratch and women can be anyone they want to be.
So tune in for this week's extra special episode. Subscribe to Meat and Three wherever you get your podcasts.
Hello and welcome to Snacky Tunes. I am one half of your host, Darren Resnitz. We sit down with one of our favorite people in LA, Royce Burke, at his new place, Yarrow Cafe. We talk about how he taught himself how to cook, growing up in a big family, the hustle and grind of being a private chef, his love for carrots, and the secrets of Chinatown, namely a secret called lasagna. Then we dig deep into the archives for one of our favorite bands from New Jersey, the Static Jacks. Here we go. Sit down and listen to Snacky Tunes here on HeritageRadioNetwork.org.
We talk about food. We talk about music with musical dudes. Finger on the pulse. Snacky Tunes.
Hello and welcome to Snacky Tunes. I'm one half your host, Darren Bresnitz, sitting with the local LA legend, Royce Burke, co-owner, owner, chef of many things, but most notably right now, Yarrow Cafe, which we just had a delicious breakfast at. Welcome to Snacky Tunes.
Thank you so much for having me.
We were Instagram friends first.
Yes.
And I think the first time we met in real life was I was finishing a meal at Friedman's, and I was getting up to leave my second home, which
yes,
is that restaurant. And I saw you at the table with your brother?
Yes.
My brother. And I was like, oh my God, I have to say, I knew that we were going to meet in real life, but I was like, well, we got to pull the Band-Aid off.
Well, we've also just known each other through our mutual friend, Kate Green's Instagram. Yeah. For some reason.
Shout out to Kate Green. Where'd you grow up?
I grew up kind of all over California, actually. I was born in Portland, Oregon. But we moved when I was 6 months old, so I never really count that.
Yeah.
And then lived in Tahoe Donner till I was 5 or 6, and then Auburn, and then Sacramento. And then I moved to St. Helena to start studying winemaking. And then San Francisco, where my family's from, and then back to St. Helena, and then to L.A.
Wow.
So California.
California. your mom cooked, right? Your mom was a big cook?
My mom cooked, I think, initially a lot from necessity. Like, my dad was originally the one who cooked a lot. But my dad worked crazy hours. He was an electrician for most of my young life. So I would like, it's, I think that's why I still get up so early, is he would leave at like 3 a.m. and then I wouldn't see him until late at night. So if I wanted to hang out with him in the morning, I had to get up crazy early and
that just stuck
breakfast.
With you.
Yeah. I haven't been able to like sleep past 6 or 7 a.m.
And so, early risers,
yeah.
Breakfast, big part of the family tradition, or was it like a coffee and eggs type of toast thing?
I think it was, we ate a lot of, we were very poor when I was young, so a lot of oatmeal,
mm-hmm.
which I still have an appreciation for.
It's good fuel.
It's a solid fuel.
Yeah.
Oatmeal, my mom put a lot of emphasis on healthier foods, which I think has stuck with me. But I think the thing that stuck with me the most, we're more of a dinner family because we're, at that point, my family was very religious. I am not anymore, obviously. but we would entertain a lot. We'd have people over from church a lot.
Gotcha.
So it was always about big dinners and everything else. And that was where my mom could just make magic out of nothing. Like, I'd look in the fridge and I'd be like, what are you going to do with it? This is
You're like, Mom,
crazy.
We have 20 people coming over. What are you going to do? And it was just like,
and she would just make some of the most delicious food I've ever had out of what appeared to be nothing. And that was, it's always been inspiring to me. And it's when I have the most fun creating things.
You know, it's funny how inspiring mom's cooking can be. It's, mm-hmm. And so many chefs go back to that because it is this magical thing when you're younger. And by younger, I mean like 5 or 6. And the idea of being like, I see a bunch of raw stuff or just a bunch of stuff in packets, and then all of a sudden it becomes this beautiful bounty that everyone's gathering around.
No, absolutely. And I think I had my mom's, you know, ability to make things out of nothing, and then my grandmother had immigrated from Alsace when she was really young. So she had like this kind of crazy French-German palate.
Mm.
And that was the first time I tried pickled herring and all this, and mm-hmm. it was like, my mom did not like it. My mom doesn't like mushrooms, which is still blows my mind.
Which, by the way, if you have the vegetable toast here with eggs.
There's a few mushrooms.
but so learning not just cooking from your mom, but also hosting gets ingrained into you, right? And that's something I think you either grow up with or you don't. You know, my mom and my dad had a very much open door policy of people mm-hmm. coming over and things like that. And so it sounds like your mom had the same.
Yeah, I think my mom and my dad both. We entertained a lot growing up, and I've just always put so much value on having people around that act like cooking for a group of people and having that, like, I don't know what to call that feeling, but it's, I think of it sometimes as more of a sound than actually as like a,
what do you mean?
It's just like I think of the sound of those things, like the smells of the food, and then wine glasses clinking and bottles, corks being pulled. Which
the din of
my current parties
like
have
that.
More corks, I think, than my girls.
Yeah.
But
you come from a big family,
yes.
Right? And you, as you mentioned, said, had limited resources growing up.
Yes.
How does that shape your journey to like getting into food and to growing up with sort of a scrappiness, but also knowing that you want to need to provide for a lot of people? And how does that approach who you are or influence? Well,
I think for most of my life, it was just something that I really enjoyed doing and being able to do at home. It was something that all the jobs I had were very stressful. I worked for a real estate development company in San Francisco, and we were going through when Millennium Tower was finished on construction, the 2008 recession hit. So there was just a lot of stress around me constantly. So it was the thing that I could just go back to calm me down. And so I'd always resisted actually doing it professionally, because I thought that would spoil.
You didn't want to sully the waters, right?
I didn't want to sully the waters. I didn't want to wake up one day and realize that I didn't enjoy cooking anymore because it was a job.
So it's, but it wasn't a job at the time.
No.
And you're self-taught, right?
Yes, self-taught. Never went to school for it. I started.
Do you ever feel that you should have gone to school? I mean, I would argue that success has found you. But do you ever itch for that?
I think every once in a while when I'm cooking with, you know, I've had the opportunity to cook with some awesome chefs, and it's like I still get a little nervous because I'm like, I don't know if he tells me to do some
like a brunoise or something like that.
Yeah, like I know how to do it, but I don't know the name.
Right.
You know, it's like it's that odd thing where I still get slightly self-conscious about it, but I've gotten less and less as time goes on, and I realize that I know how to cook and I can make it work.
So what was your first professional foray, and how did you get started with no professional background?
So my very first, there used to be a company based out of San Francisco called Kitchit, and my brother's girlfriend at the time had gone to high school with the founder. So she kept, we were in Monterey on vacation just making some dinner for the family, and she was like, why have you never done this? Like, why have you never tried to do this professionally? Because we were talking about how stressed, I had a consulting company at the time, and it was driving me crazy. My clients were a nightmare. And she's like, why haven't you tried to do this professionally? And I was like, well, I don't even know. Like, I didn't go to school for it. I don't know how I would even get started doing that. So there was this company that her high school friend had started called Kitchit. And it basically vetted private chefs and then handled, like, you'd put menus, sample menus and stuff up online.
Yeah, yeah.
And then clients would hire you through that. They provided the insurance policy, etc. And so that's kind of how I got started. The very first time I got paid to cook for somebody was someone had rented out this crazy house in Santa Barbara, and they hired me through the site. I was living between St. Helena and San Francisco, and so I took a Greyhound bus from San Francisco to Santa Barbara with all my knives and everything in my backpack, got all my ingredients at Whole Foods, terrible cost of goods.
Oh, man. What are those margins?
Yeah, not good. And got an Uber all the way up the hill to this crazy mansion that apparently the inventor of the English muffin had built.
Really?
And yeah, it was really bizarre.
Were there a lot of nooks and crannies in the house?
Good one.
Thank you.
And then cooked for six people. I had made friends with the Uber driver, so he picked me up.
Nice.
When I was done, I just texted him, paid him cash, drove back down the hill. And then my Greyhound to LA didn't leave until 6 a.m. So I sat on a park bench reading a couple cookbooks till 6 a.m. in Santa Barbara and froze my balls off.
But I mean, that's... But did that give you the confidence? Like, once you did that...
Yeah.
Like, that sort of...
Well, I think it's also...
Through.
It broke through, and it also taught me, like, everything that I'd enjoyed about other careers I'd worked in. Like, I've always enjoyed being the guy they knew they could call who could pull off what seemed to be impossible.
Who could show up.
Who, like, when we were doing Millennium Tower, you know, get the call at 2 a.m. to get an electrician out of bed to turn on a 60-story luxury tower so a billionaire could see the view from their penthouse at night.
Of course, which is a normal, I mean...
Yeah, totally normal.
Totally normal, happens all the super time.
And so, like, in the cooking setting, it was like a... like, that first dinner, I had completely forgotten an ingredient for dessert.
Yeah.
At Whole Foods. So I had to improvise on the spot. There was bananas on the counter. I ended up making, like, a caramelized banana tart or something with some cayenne some sort of cayenne maple syrup reduction. And it was delicious and everyone loved it. And it was like, I realized that if I could improvise well, then no one would ever get too mad at me.
So I want to jump ahead a little bit. As you figured out the private chef thing, you make your way to Napa. What brought you to Napa and how did you start getting into professional kitchens?
So originally I moved to Napa Valley. My cousin had just moved there from San Francisco. She subsequently married a wonderful man. They own a Costner Western Winery in St. Helena. And I was living with her, helping take care of her son, going to school at Napa Valley College and studying winemaking. Worked for Nails Vinge at Saddleback Cellars and a couple other people. And I think it was just another place that really continued the fascination with cooking because the access to ingredients was crazy. The farmer's market was so much fun.
I mean, talk about being in the source.
Oh my God. It's so dumb. And it was, my friends have this crazy property, Eller's, on Eller's Lane out there, right by Eller's Winery. And we would just throw crazy parties out there. Now, they weren't necessarily dinner parties, but were parties.
They were parties, but were you in a kitchen, and you were doing the kitchen and you're doing the parties as well?
Was this in Napa, I didn't cook professionally in Napa. I didn't start actually cooking professionally until I started moving to LA.
So you're sort of putting together your foundation in Napa, and then what brought you to LA?
I had been coming down here because my ex-wife's family lived in Orange County, so we would go visit them. Mm-hmm. And every time, I strongly dislike Orange County in general. There's some cool food things happening
out there.
Vietnamese
food down there?
It's great Vietnamese food. But I had, every time I'd spent time in Los Angeles, it was just getting harder and harder to leave. I was really falling for the city. It's crazy. I didn't know why at the time, but I just really loved it. And my friend DJ, who had moved from Calistoga up in the Napa Valley to Los Angeles, kept trying to get me to move down here.
Yeah.
And so I started crashing on his couch when I would come down more and more frequently. I was working on a documentary they were producing. I was helping produce this documentary. And I was still doing the consulting stuff, so I was still going back and forth between San Francisco and LA like three or four times a week.
Still taking the Greyhound?
Greyhound, or I think like Megabus started sometime around then, and then I was driving a lot. It was just stressful. The documentary kind of blew up because someone's emotions were too close to the surface, and actors, when they're producing, actors, it's fun.
Yeah.
I think as I started, after that first private cooking job, I started getting I was just put my location as Los Angeles.
Yeah, you're getting more jobs.
And so I started getting a lot of jobs in Los Angeles, and I just was having a blast doing it. I really enjoyed it. Even though it was insanely stressful.
Yeah.
Like after I got rid of my second car, because I couldn't pay for it anymore, because I was living in LA and getting chewed up. I was taking like three buses and a train to do a two-person dinner in Riverside for an anniversary.
And you're like, it's time to make a big change, right?
Yeah, it's just crazy. And it was like exhausting, but I still loved it. And then I got the offer to create the food program at Chimney Coffee, getting ahead of myself.
No, it's great, but I want to take a break because okay. I want to get into Chimney Coffee and I want to take into Secret Lasagna.
Yes.
But we're going to take a quick break.
Hit me.
So we're going to hear a song from the archives here on Snacky Tunes on heritageradionetwork.org.
Yeah.
Hello and welcome back to Snacky Tunes. We're here with Royce Burke of URL Cafe, Secret Lasagna, Man About Town, every food event, the guy who shows up. So we're talking about how the Siren Song of LA called you. You moved,
seduced me.
Seduced you, moved down here, and how you got involved with Chimney Coffee. For those who are not familiar with it, what is Chimney Coffee?
So Chimney was a little cafe that was completely hidden. It's owned by the same people who own Laxey Market, which is an amazing Thai restaurant supply place, but it's open to the public. So please go and buy delicious Thai food. They actually have a Thai barbecue place inside. I think it's called Laxey Barbecue.
Mm.
Inside, and The owner, Anek, his mother, is still there cooking every day. It's pretty incredible. Jonathan Gold used to go
R.I.P.
a lot, quite frequently. R.I.P. Jonathan. But yeah, so they owned this little cafe right in front of Laxey. There's zero foot traffic, zero visibility.
Sure.
And so it was just like there was local people who live in like the brewery over there,
yeah,
that knew about it. It was right near Chinatown. I was literally living across the street in a warehouse.
How was that?
It's funny. It was like we had a photography studio on one side, one truly horrible roommate. I just saw him at the Taste the other night.
Oh,
he was,
yeah,
taking pictures for somebody.
How was that?
I was like, I want to kill him.
Do you stink eye him?
Yeah. I had like several people stink eye him for me, which was good.
So you're living across from Chimney, and how did it get started? Were you just going there for coffee, and then you're like, I think I could do something here?
I was going there for coffee, and then I had become friends with the owner, and he and his brother started coming to my dinner parties. And he called me like right after the beginning of the year. It feels like February 1st or 2nd, 1 year. And the only person who was like making sandwiches in the back. And they had this massive kitchen. They weren't doing anything with it. They're just making like panini press sandwiches,
sure,
or something.
Yeah.
Had just quit. And he called me and he was like, would you be interested in doing something? Just testing something out, whatever. And so I started doing like a couple days a week, just testing out some different sandwiches or menu items or things. And then we decided to go full time. I created a full food menu. Started getting a lot of press. And we, by the time I left, we had the Silver Lake Echo Park brunch crowd down because we had a ton of parking.
Awesome.
So it was just full of strollers. We took over another space next door and expanded.
How did you feel the approach was, since you had been doing private chefing and dinner parties versus a restaurant where it's not always on your terms?
Yeah.
You know, where it's like you got to open up those doors every day. Mentally, did you enjoy that shift?
It's definitely a learning curve. There's a lot that has to change. You don't have, like, there's elements of, like, when I do just one-off events where I'm just doing stuff, I have so much fun.
Yeah.
Because you're just, there's always an element of winging it that takes place in that that's just thrilling for me, especially when you pull it off.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it was just a new challenge, and I've always loved new challenges. It definitely took a lot of learning, a lot of figuring out, especially when you and the owner don't always see eye to eye.
Sure.
You know, it takes a lot. Was good.
And it prepared you for your next spot, right?
Yeah.
Which was your first spot, Secret,
yes,
Lasagna, right?
Yes.
So Secret Lasagna is this mythical restaurant, pop-up vibe. How did that get started? What was it?
So it got started, I was planning to do another breakfast and lunch restaurant at Mandarin Plaza, and I was working on rebuilding or reconfiguring a restaurant space in Mandarin Plaza that took a lot more time and money than I expected, naively, or had. So that was fun. But at the same time, I had wanted to do something in a late night area for a while because just before that, I had been living in the Fashion District, mm-hmm, and realized that there was very few, with the exception of like LA Cafe, which is like aggressively mediocre. It was...
You got to try to be that mediocre.
It's really hard to get that mediocre, and they succeed in spoonfuls. I think Yeah, I felt like there was such a gaping hole in the late night sphere, and everyone is up at all hours doing all manner of unmentionable things, and they're hungry.
Yeah.
So I'd wanted to play in that for a while. We came up, my brother Justin, who works with me, had come up, we were probably stoned in the backyard one night, and had come up with this, with a name, Secret Lasagna.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, shit, that's really good.
It's a good name.
Like, we got to make lasagna now.
Yeah.
I had no idea what I wanted to do for the late night thing, but I knew I wanted it, especially with Chimney, we had realized how big delivery could be.
Sure.
We had started working with Uber Eats. We were the second restaurant in LA on Uber Eats when they launched here. And so I knew delivery needed to be a big factor in it, and it needed to be able to deliver hot.
Yeah.
As good as it, you know, came out of the oven. So lasagna was perfect because it's getting sent out in the same tins it's cooked in.
Right.
So it stays hot for like 45 minutes to an hour.
And it gets good.
And if it starts cooling off, it just keeps getting better.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's lasagna.
It's lasagna.
Put it in the fridge overnight and reheat it, it's getting even better.
I mean,
it's crazy.
There are times when I don't even reheat it. I'll just get up and I'll fork it. Yeah. Jones and Fred. Exactly. So you opened it up, and what was that like? Because you were now the owner, right? You were...
Yes.
So chef owner, first time. So...
It was crazy.
Yeah, it took off too, right?
It started taking off, and at the same time, the space that I was planning on doing it out of was falling apart because I couldn't finish it. It was kind of a weird nightmare scenario that was a good learning experience. I'm very thankful for Giorgio and Far East Plaza because that family has been...
They've been really good to the LA food scene.
Been really, really good to the LA
really
food
good.
Scene.
Really
and it's
good.
And it's all, like, everyone in that plaza is family. I mean, I hung the light fixtures at Lhasa. They're,
shout
they're
out.
Brothers.
Chase and Chad.
Chad and Chase. Chase and Chad.
Love those guys.
Chad's hat! So sexy.
And to Amanda and Johnny.
Yes. Love Amanda and Johnny. The sweetest people ever. Jack at Endorphine.
Oh, yeah.
Who also did my coffee program.
Coffee
at
program
Yaro.
Here is great.
Thank you, Jack.
So you're opening there and you're running it, but it wasn't open for a while.
No, it was just for delivery. And because we were working out of like a hidden commissary kitchen that I couldn't really have people.
Right.
And it was kind of crazy because as it got popular and we started getting all these write-ups, people were like looking at other people's Instagrams and finding it. Like finding us in a dark corner in Far East Plaza and trying to get into the kitchen. It's best not addressed. Murky at best.
Murky at best. And so did you shut it down before you got shut down or?
Yes. Yeah. 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 Never. I think people looked for it for a while, from the LA Health Department.
And so but, what brought you to Yaro?
So Yaro, it was kind of, I had closed Secret Lasagna, and I didn't know how to approach bringing it back at the time. I was kind of in a weird limbo state. I was doing a lot of private events again, and my personal life was a little crazy. My marriage was ending, and it was a lot. Everything was kind of happening at once.
Sometimes it happens.
Sometimes it happens, and a lot of times it's for the best. And then I met Asher and Emily, who had Hyperslow Cafe and Yoga Studio.
Yep.
And through Charlie, who makes all my aprons, White Bark Workwear.
Yeah.
Shout out.
And
instantly became really good friends with them. They just really wanted to focus on the yoga studio, and they wanted someone who could just come in and take over the whole cafe.
Which is great, because your yoga studio dreams went out the window years ago.
Oh, years ago.
Years ago.
I haven't been that flexible in a long time.
That's great, though, because a lot of times, you know, finding the space, getting it started as you've gone through, here's a spot that already exists, that already has the infrastructure of a cafe, so you just sort of focus on the menu, and not to mention that you're a stone's throw from the farmer's market.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, to go from Secret Lasagna, which had meat, and meat-heavy, to do something that is wildly vegetarian.
Wildly vegetarian. And I think, like,
what drove you to that?
My mentality didn't actually change that much because, I mean, even with Secret Lasagna, when we did the top Secret Lasagna, the vegan one, I really just wanted to throw the rulebook out instead of just doing, like, shitty gluten-free pasta.
The worst.
And it's horrible. Brown rice pasta, good Lord. And I decided to just, I focused on all the vegetable elements, and we used shredded roasted zucchini instead of using noodles, and just created something. Like, I didn't try to make the cashew cream or the ricotta substitute taste like cheese. I just tried to make them taste delicious.
Which I think is the best way to do it.
Yeah, I'm not trying, like, cheese is cheese. It comes out of an animal.
Yeah.
And then you do things to it, and it becomes cheese. Lydia will take issue with some of those statements from Detail Issues. But, yeah.
But that being said, at the cafe, you do serve the Impossible Burger.
I do. And I love, like, the Impossible Burger, I actually love not necessarily for vegans.
Yeah.
Because it tastes like meat.
Yeah.
Like, most vegans don't want that. I think of it as a product for people like me.
Right.
People like me who are, like, I enjoy meat. But I do think it should be more of a commodity. I think the meat industry as it is a big contributing factor to our global problems. And I think we, like, meat should come back to being a locally sourced thing. It should be a lot more expensive. And it shouldn't be, I had this conversation, I got really lucky when Nadine Redzepi came out to do her book signing at Now Serving. To talk to her about it, and she was saying, like, they eat meat rarely, but it's like it's a locally sourced product. They love it.
Yeah.
But it's not, like, it's not an everyday thing as much anymore.
Right. And it should not be the biggest thing when you look at your plate.
Right.
It should be mostly vegetables and grains and then meat.
And yeah, and I think taking, like, putting the Impossible Burger on the menu is, like, it's not necessarily the best business move. It's insanely expensive still for restaurants. But, like, the only way that gets cheaper is when more people start using it.
Put your money where your mouth is.
Exactly.
So, you know, in addition to Yarrow Cafe, you are a man about the scene. In the LA, I don't think there's an LA food event where you don't get called for it. I think that's partially because of your reputation of being able to show up and not run out of food.
Well, it seems like a fairly simple concept to someone like me. It's like, if someone asks you to make 2,000 portions, make 2,000 fucking portions.
Yeah. What do you love about doing those events? Outside of just obviously getting your name out and things like that, because it's a grind. It's a grind on top of that. But you do it, and you do the charity work, and you smile, and you're out, and you're posting from it. Like, what do you love about it?
I'm a very social person. I like interacting with people. I like meeting potential customers, having that, like, that first initial reaction. Also, it's just fun to do... give someone, like, a little taste of what you could do. And it's always, like, give someone something surprising. And it's, like, most of the food events, I end up doing something that's vegan or vegetarian just because no one fucking does it.
Yeah.
It's, like, these, like, LA Food & Wine, Hell Beach Food & Wine, they're all, like, dick measuring contests for chefs.
Ooh.
And so everyone's just trying to see how much...
Love it.
How much foie gras and caviar they can put on something.
Yeah.
I love foie gras and caviar as much as the next person, and I'll do caviar bumps with Dave Bernal all day, every day.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of people who don't eat meat or foie gras. Or just
something a little different at these events.
Yeah. Or just, like, something to mix it up. Something that's equally as delicious. Like, that's my biggest thing with Yarrow is... I've been really focusing on calling it vegetable focus as opposed to just vegetarian vegan.
Yeah.
Because I'm just focusing on these delicious vegetables and bringing all their flavors out as opposed to just focusing on making a bunch of dishes that are vegetarian and vegan, which means just taking the proteins out of them.
Yeah.
And that's because I feel like that's insulting to somebody who's chosen that as a lifestyle.
Right.
You're literally just like, oh, here's the leftovers.
Yeah, but...
of what was once a cool dish.
Right, but when the vegetarian-focused food is as good as at Yarrow, you don't even miss it.
Yeah, and that's the goal. Like, I don't want you to be thinking, oh, this toast would be so much better with...
bacon?
What, bacon on? No.
Or that the breakfast burrito instead of cauliflower needs chorizo.
Right. It's like, I love bacon, and I love chorizo, but I'm not doing it for this one, so I want to actually focus on some... We work with an amazing group of farmers in the Fresno Valley... Food Roots is an amazing organization that I've wanted to work with for forever and finally had a concept in a part of town where the price point that I could work at made it actually affordable to use that. And it's been so exciting. Like, getting that delivery every Friday literally tickles me pink. Like, the tomatoes are so freaking good.
I mean, tomatoes, I've said, when you see tomatoes as a lead ingredient on a dish in the summer in LA, that's what you're ordering.
Yeah.
Now, before we run out of time, I just want to sort of bring it all together because, you know, you've made your way to LA, you've carved out your own spot, you're a man about town. How do you feel about your place in the scene in itself? You know, do you feel that you, I know that you said that you sometimes can get intimidated, but I feel like you've written your own check here, which not a lot of chefs get to do, especially, you know, if all you focus on is coming up in the traditional way, which there's nothing wrong with, and I think there's absolutely, like, a beauty in that.
Yeah.
But where do you feel that you sit in this scene? What do you think the current state is? Where do you see the future of the LA scene, food scene, going?
Well, I mean, the LA food scene has, the sky's the limit for what we do. I think I take issue with a lot of people who want, like, obviously, everyone knows the Michelin Guide is going to come back to LA. If it doesn't, it's a bad move on Michelin's part. Because
I mean, it's crazy.
It needs, like, they need us for credibility at this point. LA does not need the Michelin Guide, nor do 90% of the people who are not Curtis Stone want it back. And nothing against Curtis Stone. I don't want the Michelin Guide here. I think a lot of what we've been able to accomplish as chefs here and building these restaurants that are actually speaking to chefs' roots and their cultures is because we weren't worried about white tablecloth experiences. And, you know, it's like, I like the elements of service that I think, you know, people can always work on. Like, maybe when a fork drops under my table, pick it up.
But I mean, here's the thing, is that even a place like Mod, which is one of the most fine dining places and delicious, is its own type of fine dining.
Yes.
That you would not find in New York, because at that price point in New York, you need unlimited captains. You need the white tablecloth. You need that. Like, that is a place that's unique to LA because it's like market driven, it's regional driven, it's idea driven.
Yeah. Also, shout out to Andre for the best wine list.
Andre, and shout out to Justin for holding it down in the kitchen.
Yes.
Their Piedmont end of year menu.
Oh my God, that was really good. That mushroom dish killed me.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think as far as my place in the scene, I hope I keep getting to make great food. And I think, you know, there's a lot of places to go for the LA food scene. It's all going to be good. And I just want to keep doing everything I can. Like, I know I have an advantage over a lot of people because I'm 6 feet tall and white and a man. But I, you know, everything I can do to continue putting attention on people like, you know, my homies at Lhasa and my buddy blanking on names all over the place. Charles Alalia. Oh my God. But just like, none of these people I just want, my friend Rhea at PCP is making incredible food, and I'm crazy excited to see what she does in the future.
Yeah.
I just like, I want people who don't always
fit the mold.
That's why LA is so special. That's why I love this city so much.
Me too.
And why I'm never leaving.
No,
you're stuck with me.
It celebrates all food, all kinds, and makes it a very level playing field.
Yes.
Royce, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
So great. If people want to come visit you at Yarrow Cafe online in real life, where can they go?
So, YarrowCafeLA.com. I just Yarrow Cafe on Instagram, Royce_Burke on the IG. And then Yarrow is located at 487 South Fairfax, a block from LACMA and like a block and a half from The Grove, something like that.
And
it's right in between.
Awesome. And stay tuned for some secret lasagna.
It's coming, baby.
Big news. Off the record. Wink, wink. So stick around. We have a live performance coming up in studio. But here is another song from the archive on Snacky Tunes on heritageradionetwork.org.
Today's program was brought to you by Roth Cheese, a pioneer in the U.S. specialty cheese movement. Roth is in its 25th year of making specialty cheese in the rolling hills of southern Wisconsin. With strong Swiss heritage, Roth is best known for its award-winning Alpine-style cheeses under the name Grand Cru. Fresh Wisconsin milk, combined with expertise in affinage, is how Roth creates high-quality, great-tasting cheese year after year. In 2016, hard work paid off when out of over 2,000 contenders, Roth Grand Cru Sirchois was named world champion at the World Cheese Championship. For more information, visit rothcheese.com.
Speaking of singing,
move along.
We got the Static Jackson here.
Not bad.
Not bad. Working on it.
Transition 101.
Yeah.
Transition
101. Yeah. Welcome, guys.
Thank you.
Hello. Thanks for having us.
Jersey natives, now New Yorkers, most of you?
No, still
New
still Jersey.
Yeah.
What are you representing in Jersey?
No, better question. What diner do you represent in New Jersey?
I represent Vicky's Diner.
Westfield, New Jersey. Vicky's, yeah.
Yeah? What do you get? What's special?
Their cheeseburgers are amazing.
Good tuna melt?
Yeah, they have a great tuna melt.
Diner tuna melt in Jersey? That might be my last meal.
Wait a second.
It's fantastic.
But I still want to know where you represent in Jersey. Where you live? North? South?
Oh, central. Central Jersey.
So that would mean if you were rooting for a hockey team, you'd be rooting for?
Rangers.
The Devils. Come on. I mean, they're
Rangers.
Not.
Rangers.
Oh, here. See, this is the
and that, wait, and that's the end of Snaggy
Tune. That's the end of Snaggy,
because we are both Flyers fans, and you guys can go.
You watch the Winter Classic?
Oh, yeah.
You watch 24/7?
Yes, I
we did.
Yeah.
Well, no, you know what? Actually, I watched the first three 24/7, and then I didn't watch the last one, because like, I do not need to watch the Flyers lose again.
No, they actually win in 24/7.
Yeah.
They rewrote it.
Yeah,
that's the way the refs won, at least.
Yeah. So welcome.
Conspiracies.
So wait, how much time do you spend commuting into New York City, or do you guys have like a home base set up in Jersey, like clubs and shows you play, or how does it work?
We used to commute into New York a lot, because before we had any like representation or label support or anything, we used to go to Union Square and just we busked every single day, and that's actually that helped us get a lot of our team members, I feel like, who we have now. So we did
give us one story.
Yeah.
And a shout out opportunity as well.
Let's see.
Story from busking. They're like crazy ones about like the homeless people that we
give us a positive. The crazy ones.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like, this is positive. There is a homeless guy who in Union Square who hates Brad Pitt. That's not the positive part. The positive part is that whenever we would get like shit from other performers, maybe who wanted to come in, like when we were on a quick break or whatever, this homeless guy would go and like yell at them, like, "Nah, this is their spot. Get out of here!" And people
awesome.
Would leave.
Yeah.
JR. Shout out to JR.
And now
JR.
He sells merch for you guys.
And there we go.
Which is
now
so
he's
awesome.
He's our
so amazing.
Yeah.
That's a true New York story. Yeah.
So it's your lawyer.
Yeah.
So you pay him more money.
I hate Brad Pitt. Pay them more money. Yeah.
So you know, things started getting better, and then you just kept things more Jersey, or you really didn't have to spend as much time like.
It's really a matter of like, we don't have any money and we're not making money, so we have to live at home still. But New York is, it's like, you know, with no traffic, a 20-minute drive or a train ride. So like,
PATH train.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
The PATH train. And
What's it like busking in Union Square?
It was always an adventure.
I mean, it's not as good now because, like, apparently all the rules changed. We kind of stopped doing it because they made you stand like right on the curb where all the cars were always racing by, and you couldn't hear anything because there were just like trucks idling and stuff.
Just got real tense in here.
These food trucks.
We're not allowed back.
What was it like that first day that you're setting up? Did you just like, we're going to go to Union Square and busk, or did you have to talk to somebody?
No,
we just did it. It was kind of like scary.
I was really scared.
I guess I'm just gonna start singing really loudly right now.
Was it all acoustic, or did you have any like small amplifiers?
Well, we would bring a briefcase and drumsticks and a tambourine, and I would like bang on all these things, and we would all be singing, and there'd be two acoustic guitars, and we used to bring a little amp for a bass, like a wireless. But that got shut down pretty quickly, because we figured out the rules pretty quickly. Like, there are certain areas of on the subway where you just can't do it because you need a permit. But then there are certain times of the day where they'll like be kind of lenient with you. But then if you have anything electrical, they don't joke around with that stuff. They make you shut it. You need a permit for anything like that. Mm. So we stopped bringing that.
So that pan flute guy's got a permit.
Yeah, right. he
yeah. He's made a career out of that. I mean, every day since I've been here for hustling, 6 years. Man. Yeah. Why don't we hear a song? Let's knock it out of tune. Something. What are you guys gonna?
Hey,
pick first?
Why don't you something from the busking days?
Should we do one of the old busking ones?
Yeah. Which.
Or not.
No,
let's do it.
Yeah.
Don't let them back down.
I was just trying. Yeah. I was trying for something. I was trying for a nice transition, unlike.
Yeah, let's do Walls.
Yeah, we'll do Walls.
Which way?
Would this go?
Here.
I guess. Yeah.
Okay. I don't have the briefcase. It has since been retired, but I'll.
Do you want to use that pizza?
I could maybe bang these together in some sort of. No, I'm going to use my body parts.
All right, here we go. Stack Jacks live on Stack Tunes.
All right. Do you need headphones?
No.
All right.
Metronome.
Okay. Here, you might want to listen.
Nice. Sounds this is a little different from the record.
How did you not blow your voice out?
No, but I was like
busking.
Busking. Yeah,
I
yeah.
did. That was a
I
big very problem. Much did. It was a big problem because I like would have to like not do it before we would like if we had like a show on Friday. I could only do it like Monday and Tuesday because otherwise I would just like have no voice.
I can imagine.
Yeah.
And they wouldn't let you have, like, any amplified vocals at all for...
No. No.
Definitely not.
Not even, like, one of those old, like, 1940s, you know, rowing
once
mega...
Once they saw cable.
I guess...
Cops came.
No, 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 that's...
Oh, you know, he means just, like, the cone?
Yeah, the cone.
Oh, yeah.
I guess...
We could have used you guys back then.
Yeah. Hey, yeah. So, hey, that's a free one, guys.
Thanks.
So how did you go from busking to Fearless Records?
How does anyone get to Fearless Records? No,
through El Paso.
I don't even know how. That was the last piece of the puzzle, actually, in our career.
Are we missing some pieces?
I mean, yeah.
Okay.
Like on the strength of the busking and the EP we had released, we went down to South by. Yeah, it was self-released. It was called Laces, and we went down to South by Southwest, like kind of on our own.
What year?
Oh, man, that was 2010, right?
2010.
Yeah, 2010. And we came back with our booking agent, Heather Kolker at Paradigm. And that was, like, the first major, piece of the puzzle anyone who had, like, decided they were going to take us on in the industry.
Except for our lawyer, JR. Yeah,
except for our lawyer.
Yeah. JR.
Yeah. He was on day one. JR, man, he's been there since day one.
He's really been a treasure. And then it just kind of like every like everything else fell into place, and Fearless was like the last piece, and we've just kind of been touring on and off as much as we can ever since. And
you guys are going across the pond in February.
Yeah, yeah. Like a week, yeah. Actually.
For
no, like a what?
It's like a week from now.
Oh, it's, yeah. Yeah. It's not, we're going to be there for like a month in a week.
That's amazing. And where are you
first,
go?
First time over there?
We were in London over Thanksgiving, actually, for the week, playing a bunch of shows when they weren't on holiday break because they don't celebrate.
They don't celebrate. Yeah.
Nobody cared.
Nobody cared.
Where are you guys? Where are you guys absconding to?
We start in Paris on February 8th.
Yeah.
And then we move
heard
around.
Of it.
Yeah.
Heard of it.
We move around Germany, Switzerland,
Netherlands, Belgium,
and then we go back to England.
Yeah. Any food you're excited to try while you're over there?
What were the things that we ate when we were like? I don't think we tried anything.
Belgian waffles and chocolate.
We're excited about going to Belgium.
You got to go get those salty beef bagels on the end of Brick Lane in London.
The bagel are not made out of beef.
Last time.
I know how that sounded. There's beef in between the bagels.
Okay. But they're not big. It's,
yeah, whatever you say.
Yeah.
We'll tell you. Yeah. No, London's great. Right, London's great for food. And are you excited to go to Europe? I mean, this is big.
Yeah.
There's a bunch of amazing things that we're doing over there that we've never even come close to doing anything like that.
Such
before.
As?
The reason we planned this tour was because we were on tour with the Wombats through all of the fall in America, and they invited us to play 3 shows with them in London, and one of them's at Brixton Academy, which is like
awesome.
We built the tour around that, and then we're playing with like a show with our good friend Devin Thierault, who I think was in here.
Yeah, was here last week.
Oh yeah, Devin was in here two weeks ago with the wonderful Allie in Georgia.
Yeah. We listen. He's a funny guy, Devin.
He's a funny guy. Yeah. He's loud. I mean, his music is.
Yeah.
He's got personality.
He's got personality.
He does. We love Devin, and we're excited to be there with him. And so
good
we're
friends,
just you know.
Good friends Howler.
Yeah. So did you find that like Howler, yeah. You had a couple anchor shows, and then like once you were over there, it all just kind of began to like roll out.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Do you have a European team as part of your puzzle?
Yeah, we have a UK and European like booking agent.
Shout out,
Steve Zapp. Shout out.
This is the time.
This is the time.
It's time to get it all out.
See you next week.
Yes.
Steve's out.
What are you guys got a van? What are you guys? How are you guys getting around?
Well, here we do have a van, and actually, to connect the puzzle, a lot of the money that we used on the van we made while busking, so that was actually very profitable for us.
Yeah.
But in Europe, we I think we have a driver who we used last time in a Sprinter because we can't drive over there. Like
you can't drive.
A mess. I mean, we could, but I think no one felt comfortable with renting a van and having just us drive for that whole time.
I wouldn't trust you.
Yeah, I wouldn't trust us either.
If you guys could see these faces, I wouldn't trust
them. They're from Jersey. Have you ever seen anyone who drives from Jersey? It's terrible.
I mean, we're already on the left side of the road in New Jersey. Yeah.
Why don't we get another song?
They'd be like, make a left turn. Like, I can't.
Just cutting people off.
Exactly.
Why don't we play something off the record?
Sure.
Static Jacks, here we go again, live on Snacky Tunes.
Sure. Thighs here. I could bang on. Is that? No, that won't resonate. Oh, maybe I'll do a little of that. There we go. There we go.
Tone change.
Is that 2? No, that'll be good.
Yeah. Sounds like a kit.
Yeah. All right.
Just in the fire in the way through the door.
Yeah. What's that song called?
Into the Sun.
It's what we played at the opening.
Yeah.
People just tuning in, they might want to know.
Yeah, people just tuning in.
Actually, we usually just do podcasts.
Yeah. When you
look pretty dumb.
When you write a jam like that, what's the process? And at what point do you look over each other and you go, we just wrote a killer jam?
That one literally happened like that, where we were in the basement like trying to figure out that chorus. And then when someone played that lead part, we literally looked at each other and went, oh, that's a, like, that's right. Great.
I'm sorry, what's the lead part?
The like, whatever the chorus, yeah.
But like the working title of that song was Pop City. That's how we felt about that.
I mean, it's you know.
It turned out to be not at all, but in the originally we were like
this is
the poppiest thing.
This is gold.
Yeah.
So pop gold. When you guys write something like that, and then I know you did the record with Chris Shaw, who's like Ted Leo, who are huge fans of
Weezer. Oh, do you like Ted Leo?
Weezer.
Well, I mean, you know, I call him on Sundays. We trade vegan recipes.
Oh, my God.
But when you write a song like that, how does someone like Chris come in and like kind of hone it or, you know, help you guys elevate it to like another level?
It was all, I guess, like in his production, like the way, I mean, he's an engineering genius, I think. I mean, he just really gets like a loud, full sound. Like, you know, he engineered Weezer's Blue album and like the guitars on that are like unbelievable.
I mean, yes.
To this day.
One of my all-time favorites.
Yeah. So, I mean, just to, I mean, have that on your resume pretty much gave us an idea of what.
You ever hear the Blue album?
Yeah.
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 I did that.
Exactly.
He literally had stories about, like, he'd be like, oh, yeah, me and Bob. And we were like, Bob? And he's like, oh, sorry, Bob Dylan. Like, yeah, right. We were just hanging out, and we were like.
Like me and Ted?
Yeah, like you and Ted. Yeah.
It's never you and Ted. It's me and Mia.
Me and Mia. Yeah, there we go. There it is.
But, yeah.
And so now you guys gearing up, you guys going to meet us down in Austin, South By?
I really hope so. We haven't been there since that first original time. And I think, I mean, it's like, unless we're offered like an amazing tour through all of March, we really want to go.
Yeah. It's, you didn't think about record cycles when you were writing that first record. Yeah. And it didn't like really factor in like an August release. What does that really mean?
I know. Screw the pooch on that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fine. It seems to be working out for you guys quite well.
It's good, yeah.
And what are you looking forward to doing? What are you guys hoping to do? Just full U.S. tour after Europe and just
keep... I mean, yeah, we're always looking to tour. It's kind of like, offer us a tour. We'll go on it.
Maybe contact JR.
JR.
Yeah, right? The details.
No, dude.
Yeah. Is there a new driver?
Yeah, too bad he blew that Moneyball sync job. And hopefully maybe one day tour with Label Mates, ATDI.
Yes, that would be interesting.
At the drive-in.
God, that would be
wow. Right. Yeah. Well, we want to thank you guys for coming on.
Thank you for having us.
Shout out to your publicist. She was relentless in the best way possible.
It sounds like you have a good team.
Yeah.
You have a good team.
Yeah.
And are the busking days over? Are you going to do like a 10-year busking anniversary?
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe.
I mean, we love to busk. It's just it seems like the law got a lot stricter. Like we never used to get kicked out, and then the last few times we went, they would make us move, and we were like, this is ridiculous.
They have, like, markers now on the ground where you can go, and it's, like, right in the crosswalk.
It's all that
like,
long hair, guys.
I know.
Short haircuts and ties. You won't get kicked out of anywhere.
Yeah. It's true.
That's really
So why don't we close out with one more song?
Wait a second.
Sure. Okay.
How can people find you?
Oh, yeah.
What is your Friendster profile?
Friendster? I don't think I was born for that.
Oh, come on.
We're a little too young to be dated.
Yeah.
No, it's just facebook.com/thestaticjacks or thestaticjacks.com, or you can email us, you know, thestaticjacks@gmail.com.
There you go.
Gmail.
Twitter @thestaticjacks.
We do have a MySpace. I don't know if anyone's used it since 2007.
And where can they buy the record?
The record you can buy, I think, like anywhere, like definitely online, Amazon, iTunes. It should be in like your local Barnes & Noble and FYE.
Strawberry, Sam Goody, et cetera.
Sam Goody.
Coconut Records.
Oh,
Coconut
my God. We Records had a Sam Goody in our town for like years.
Peaches, yes. All the when you needed a fruit name to be a record store back in the 80s and 90s. Well, guys, thank you so much, Brian.
Thank you so much.
Yep. We'll be
Big
back.
Big ice cream.
Big ice cream. And we'll be back next week. You won't.
No, I won't. But next week is Edie Sedgwick, the band.
And the actress. Surprise. No, just kidding.
So, you guys are all like,
wow, Nurse Jackie is
Yeah,
here.
No.
And stay tuned for 2 weeks for our... third annual
Jordana
Rothman Time Out New York trend report.
Oh, and also just a quick shout out to everyone who sent in the kind well wishes and words after the show.
last week.
Really? I only got an email from Mom. Oh.
That's it. Mom, right. Thanks, Mom. But I was trying to make it seem more important than we were, but we're not that important.
Mom's pretty important.
And we are, and we'll be down at South By. So if you guys go down there, we're doing a big old panel. Snacky Tunes Live. So here we go. Stack Jacks, one last time. What do you take? What's the name of the song?
This is Young Guns, and it's a new one that'll be on an EP coming out later this year.
Is it about the movie?
It is about the movie.
Young Guns 2.
He wasn't born.
You see what you did, yeah.
Escape the nightmare that became your whole life. Keep it silent while the whole house sleeps. And you whisper so softly to me. You say, like you wanted me to, but on a larger scale, these things might not do. But we'll ignore them like the rats from your school, whose little glances and banter comments will only drive us to strike out that much harder. I don't really want to run, but I come undone, looking at me like you don't want to do it. When the sun comes up, we'll be far from fucked. Pretty soon you'll see that I knew it. I don't know what to say. It won't be better if we stay. Young guns, young artillery.
Thanks for listening to Heritage Radio Network, food radio supported by you. For our freshest content and to hear about exclusive events, subscribe to our newsletter. Enter your email at the bottom of our website, heritageradionetwork.org. Connect with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at @heritage_radio. Heritage Radio Network is a nonprofit organization driving conversations to make the world a better, fairer, more delicious place. And we couldn't do it without support from listeners like you. Want to be a part of the food world's most innovative community? Rate the shows you like, tell your friends, and please join our community by becoming a member. Just click on the beating heart at the top right of our homepage. Thanks for listening.